My name is Len Kinzel, or Kinzel, as it is pronounced by Latinos. I am a bookaholic and a learnaholic who self-published his first book just before last Christmas. Writing books is the most recent byproduct of my appetite for learning. For decades before that, most of what I ravenously learned turned into weekly sermons in local churches. I keep nagging God to let me get back to that, but for now, I am content to keep plugging away at books. These days, audio books often go hand in hand with the ones you can read, so I tried to turn my first book into one of those. However, my perfectionism combined with the amazing technology that exists for audio editing, and I was driving myself crazy doing dozens of takes of single paragraphs, re-recording the way I said a word or a phrase, or cutting out the tiniest pop or breath, trying to create this technically perfect audiobook. Finally, I decided to cut myself some slack and create a YouTube channel to feature the book. I quickly learned what goes there is a lot like what we used to call a radio program when I started in news in the 80s, and then learned to craft a church service online as the words corona and then COVID steamrolled across most of this planet. The hardest part is already done. I've done all the research, and I have the heart of a script, the book. For whatever reason, reading it into the form of a YouTube video rather than an audiobook frees me from self-imposed pressure to try to get every syllable right, whatever that means. So, this is the first of what I hope will be a 10-part podcast. The first chapter of Dare to Ask God, Questions for God and Questions about God. Chapter 1, Hope for the emotionally constipated.
My name is Len, and I am a bookaholic. I don't remember a time I wasn't one. I'm a learnaholic too, but I don't know which afflicted me first, or if one feeds another more than the other. I can't think of a stage in life when I wasn't chronically curious. I've often been guilty of driving people crazy with questions. I didn't realize it at the time, but that had a lot to do with why I quickly grew bored with being a DJ in broadcasting school and settled into my first newsroom shortly after graduation. Late cultural critic and prolific writer Neil Postman believed, "Everything we know has its origins in questions. Questions, we might say, are the principal intellectual instruments available to human beings. They're also essential for a good reporter, but my propensity for asking questions permeates pretty much everything I do, and that didn't end when I left journalism in the late 90s, in large part due to what I sense the industry becoming, so you can likely imagine what I think of it now. Stumbling into a church for the first time in my early 20s triggered a whole new wave of questions. And if the people who were part of my first Bible studies thought I asked a lot of questions, they would have been blown away by how many I kept to myself. Not all the ones that made it out of my mouth were appreciated by the leaders, but many of my fellow young adults would grab me afterward and confide, "I'm glad you're here. You ask questions I'm afraid to ask." All of that may have had a lot to do with why I latched on to a significantly underknown character from history, and why I found myself drawn back to him many times over the 35 years since I met him. What exists from Habakkuk almost 3,000 years after he lived only takes up 3 chapters in the Bible, but they're full of question marks. I feel like my friends from that Bible study. I'm glad he's in the Bible, because he asked a lot of the questions I've had, and many I still have, and he put them straight to God. That's one of many reasons he is revered by Christians, Jews, and Muslims, although precious little exists about him or from him outside of a few pages in the Bible. What is in the Bible from Habakkuk often comes across like a diary, and many modern Bible translations call it Habakkuk's complaint. It opens with the first of many questions, the kind many people seem reluctant to put to God. Oh Lord, how long must I call for help before you listen? And his exasperation quickly grew. I shout to you for help in vain, but there is no answer. Help! All kinds of things happened over the past couple of years to get many, if not most of us, sobbing into our pillows or shaking our fists at the sky and asking some version of, how long is this gonna go on? Most people are familiar with the emotions that can rain down with the question, whether they ask it in anguish or anger, or believe in or belittle God. I've hit countless places in the journey where I could relate to Habakkuk's questions, oozing with that kind of angst. My inner reporter has always one more question about what was going on in his world to trigger such transparent frustration with God, especially since what he was venting seems like it would hit close to home for many people today. How long, O Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen? Violence is everywhere, I cry, but you do not come to save. Must I forever see these evil deeds? Why must I watch all this misery? Wherever I look, I see destruction and violence. I am surrounded by people who love to argue and fight. The law has become paralyzed, and there is no justice in the courts. The wicked far outnumber the righteous, so that justice has become perverted. I can't imagine Habakkuk would put that any differently if he could be transported through time and spent a week scrolling through today's news. Many people in the modern Western world would be more than a little surprised to see how many parallels there are between a lot of their realities and what was going on in Habakkuk's Middle East 2,600 years ago. Many, if not most people, think what is in the Bible is apart from history, but it actually chronicles significant parts of history. It's not apart from history, it is a part of history. However, turning to it to try to understand certain aspects of history can be tricky, especially because huge periods of time can be covered by just turning a few pages. For example, the Bible I'm reading most these days has 65 pages covering the time from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob to Joseph, and then on to the Israelites suffering as slaves under the Egyptians when Moses appeared on the scene to lead them out of Egypt and into the Promised Land. That's a span of about 500 years. Another 500 years passed before David became a key figure in the history of the Israelites and of the entire world. That means more than 1,000 years passed between Abraham hearing God tell him about an exceptional nation that would be built through his family line, and when that nation began to take shape under King David. After years of life as wandering vagabonds, David wanted permanence for the Israelites, climaxing with a fixed focal point of worship, the temple in Jerusalem, the city he claimed as his home. David was an exceptional general, leader, and man, but he still messed up. A lot. He messed up so much, God told him he was not going to be the one who would build the temple. That would be left to one of his sons, Solomon. Now, you may wonder what any of this has to do with Habakkuk, and I plead for your patience, because that brief history lesson plays a huge part in the brutally honest questions he put to God. With the national border lines drawn and the temple complete, the people of Israel finally hit a point of relative peace and even prosperity for a time. Then King Solomon died. It didn't take long for things to begin going downhill for the Israelites. Much of what Solomon had done came through increasingly unpopular taxes, and that had emotions boiling as much as anything. Then disagreements between Solomon's sons turned into disputes, which turned into heated conflicts, which ended up splitting Israel in two. What was known as the New Israel was made up of 10 tribes in the north and 2 in the south, known as Judah. The southern area was also known as Jerusalem, with that key city remaining the nation's capital. It didn't take much for the Babylonians to swoop in, take control, and lead most of the northern Jews into exile. And that left Judah alone, isolated and vulnerable militarily, morally, and spiritually. Whether in the north, the south, or in exile, most Israelites began to forget God, and a series of foolish and or dangerous kings filled the land with sites and temples to a whole bunch of other gods. This is just one example of how bad things got. King Manasseh also murdered many innocent people, including fellow Jews, until Jerusalem was filled from one end to the other with their innocent blood. Well, Manasseh's son Amon took over, and he abandoned the Lord, the God of his ancestors, and he refused to follow the Lord's ways. Then Amon's own officials conspired against him and assassinated him in his palace. Then people of the land killed all those who had conspired against King Amon, and they made his son Josiah the next king. That gives a little picture of just how horrible things were in divided Israel. Can you even begin to imagine what it would have been like to be Josiah as the new leader of that mess? What if I added one other detail? Josiah was 8 years old when he became king. Sisters of 8-year-old boys tend to be uniquely shocked by that verse. We don't have time to get into how it was even possible, which is a bitter relief because, frankly, it's one of the parts of the Bible I don't understand, at least not yet. The Bible briefly chronicles some of the key things that happened under Josiah's reign as a teenager, and then slows down to provide details of what happened when he was 26 and overseeing some major work on the temple. It was in terrible shape after years of neglect and misuse and theft, and Josiah ordered extensive cleaning and reconstruction. As that was going on, the high priest found some long-forgotten scrolls, and what was uncovered became the first 5 books in most modern Bibles. Josiah and the high priest began going through the scrolls, and as they read, they were moved to tears as they learned all the ways the Israelites had turned from God. Josiah called people from all over the nation to hear it read, and even though it was short-lived, most committed themselves to turn their hearts and their minds to God. And that had a lot to do with why Josiah went down in history with the kind of reputation he had. The Bible says never had there been a king like Josiah who turned to the Lord with all his heart and soul and strength. As awesome as that is, we need to keep it in perspective. That was in Judah. It was globally insignificant, especially compared to the 3 world powers at the time. Think in terms of, say, Arkansas up against the rest of the United States, China, and Russia. See, at that time, there was Assyria. Its place as the world power was fading then. Egypt had been a major player for a long time, but was also in decline. And in sharp contrast, there were the Babylonians. They were brutally violent and on the rise. Egypt's leader sent a letter to Josiah telling him he wanted to take his army through Judah and into Assyria. The Egyptian leader had likely figured out if he had any chance against the Babylonians, he would need to beat the Assyrians and pull them together to fight the Babylonian forces. Well, King Josiah denied the request, but the Egyptian army rolled through Judah anyway. Judah and his forces tried to fight back, but it was pointless, and he died in battle. After that, a series of his sons made their way to the throne. In distinct ways, they showed themselves to be fools, and all the good that had come under Josiah was completely undone. Meanwhile, Judah was caught in the middle of battles between the Babylonians, the Assyrians, the Egyptians, and a variety of smaller other forces. And that finally brings us to Habakkuk. No records have been found of what he did for a living, nor how old he was. Not even the Bible mentions his family. All we know about him comes through what looks like part of his diary or a prayer journal in the midst of all that brutal chaos in Israel's history. His name meant to embrace or grasp firmly. It seems like he was trying to do that with God, and that's another reason I relate to him the way I do. The Bible has books from 17 prophets. Some scholars say 4, some say 5 are major, and 12 or 13 are minor. Habakkuk is a minor prophet, but that doesn't have anything to do with his value or the significance of what he wrote. Minor is about the length of what we have from them. And in the case of Habakkuk, there are 3 chapters. In English, 56 verses. The chapter and verse numbers weren't put in Bibles until about 2,000 years after Habakkuk wrote, and they were not divinely inspired the way the words they separate and organize were. And what we have from Habakkuk is basically an open dialogue between a confused and desperate person and God. In the opening line, some Bible versions call it a prophecy, an oracle, or a message. Some use the word burden. The word that was originally there was often used for the load someone would put on an animal. One scholar of ancient Hebrew says the word referred to carrying a heavy load physically, emotionally, and spiritually. You get a sense of that when Moses used the word in one of his exasperated exchanges with God. That time he asked, "Why are you treating me, your servant, so harshly? Have mercy on me. What did I do to deserve the burden of all these people?" If we could see body language and hear tone of voice, Moses and Habakkuk likely would have looked and sounded a lot alike as they dared to address God the way they did. There had to have been intense emotions behind their words. And that is why what we have from Habakkuk is unlike any of the other 65 books and letters that make up the Bible. It gives us a unique opportunity to eavesdrop on someone going back and forth with God over a variety of heavy things pulled from their equivalent of the headlines. If you were to summarize how Habakkuk launched into it with God, it would basically be, "What in the world is going on, and why?" His words would have likely sounded harsher than that, but this is my first book, and I'm trying to keep a G rating with it. And this book is for those of us who have had, or will have hard questions for God about hard things going on, personally, locally, nationally, or globally. It's also for people who regularly enjoy supernatural peace amid the things that are going on. Paul the Apostle wrote about how the whole body suffers when just one part suffers. If you don't believe that, you've likely never experienced the whole body experience that can come from smashing your baby toe against a piece of furniture in the middle of the night. Healthy parts of the body are to keep learning to care about and how to come alongside hurting parts of the body. And Habakkuk's pain is evident, at least where he was when he began writing. Things were weighing very heavily on his heart and his mind and his soul. And then he got right into it with God, not holding back in the least. Even though he wrote 2,600 years ago, as you look at the words from some contemporary versions of the Bible, think about how intense his angst would be today. And if you're looking at this slide, I apologize for the small font. I wanted to include it all in one. Lord, I continue to ask for help. How long will you ignore me? How long must I beg for your help before you listen? Why do you allow violence and lawlessness and crime and cruelty to spread everywhere? I cried to you about the violence, but you did nothing. People are stealing things and hurting others. They're arguing and fighting. Criminals crowd out honest people and twist the laws around. Evil people gain while good people lose. The judges no longer make fair decisions. Why do you make me look at these terrible things? As I mentioned, because of how my brain is wired, I ask a lot of questions like that. As a pastor, I hear a lot of questions like it. Questions people have for and about God and oozing with all kinds of emotions. People don't typically ask for time with me to talk about how great things are with them and God and how he's making perfect sense to them. I realize that may skew my view of people and may lead me to overgeneralize, but I believe pretty much everyone hits places where we ask, in our minds, if we don't feel safe to ask them out loud, things like, God, what in the world are you doing? If you are loving, if you are good, how can this be happening? Or, if you're all-powerful, why didn't you make that happen or keep that from happening? Why didn't somebody pull a police officer off a man dying in a parking lot? Why did you let the virus spread so far? Why aren't you making the tumor shrink? Why did or didn't you let him get elected? Those kinds of questions are as common among people inside the church as they are outside. I believe stifling those kinds of questions for too long can lead to a condition I call emotional constipation. As with the other type of constipation, it only gets worse if it is not addressed. And just like our bellies, our minds can hit the point where something needs to be let loose, or the whole body will start to suffer and eventually be damaged. I've recently learned we don't just have neurons in our brains. It's been fascinating to study and think about the implications of having neurons and intelligence in our hearts and even in our intestines. Along the way, I've found the people behind Exploring Your Mind, who wrote in part, the nervous system in your gut has up to 5 times more neurons than your spinal cord. This extremely complex neural network houses hundreds of millions of neurons. If that weren't enough, your gut is in constant connection with the brain, mediating important functions such as serotonin production. There's another significant player in this mind-gut connection as well, gut microbiota, which is essential in what's still a mysterious, catch this, conversation between your stomach and your brain. That's part of a growing list of reasons I have for being very sensitive to my own emotional constipation and for wanting to help others with theirs. Hard things held inside for too long almost always burst, and exploding thoughts and emotions can be very dangerous and very contagious. We meet Habakkuk at a point in his life where he had grown tired of keeping them in. He was confused. He was frustrated. He even seems to have been angry. It's as though he got specific with something the great warrior King David wrote while hiding in a cave. He wrote, I pour out my complaints before God. I know many people who believe there's something wrong with that, that we should never question, doubt, or disagree with God. I believe if that were true, we would need to tear a lot of the Psalms out of our Bible, and we would have to rip out a lot of Habakkuk. U.S. Founding Father Thomas Jefferson did something just like that. He took a razor and scissors and cut out parts of the New Testament he didn't agree with or didn't like. It's known as the Jefferson Bible. You can Google that. As far as we know, Jefferson never dissected the Old Testament, but many people seem to find it easy to pretend parts of it don't exist, especially the kinds of questions Habakkuk put to God. And as I mentioned, the journal entry we have from him is full of question marks. He does build to a few big exclamation marks, and we will get to those. But if we don't spend the right kind of time with the questions, we won't be as amazed by the answers as we need to be. I believe finding freedom and safety to ask God our most profound questions will go a long way in helping us see how real and how close He is, and how deeply He cares and wants to hear from us. As much as anything, that's what I keep finding in Habakkuk. Next time, we'll dive into Chapter 2 of Dare to Ask God Questions, Questions for God and Questions about God. Chapter 2 is titled, Is God Good? All the time?
Sanctify me. I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange.